Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to attempt to talk this evening about finding the key to economic growth, for sustainable economic growth for Trinidad and Tobago. Now, of course, we're talking to an international audience, and one may wonder whether or not there's relevance for other countries. The truth is, the challenge of low economic growth has been faced by six groupings of small island developing states around the world. This is a challenge faced by a number of groupings of small island developing states, so about 42 countries. And of course, many of them have attempted to meet this challenge head on. The problem for small island developing states in the Caribbean is that they have faced economic growth of half that of these other groupings of small island developing states. We in Trinidad and Tobago have been a bit fortunate in that we've experienced rather high levels of growth, but of course, bar the last 6 years. So I'm going to attempt to do this by in the following sequence. First, I'm going to attempt to give you a sense of what has been the trend of economic growth over the last 55 years. Then I would look at the growth rates over the last 22 years. I would also look at what were the strategies that were adopted over the last 55 years that took us from where we were in the 1960s to where we are today. Finally, I would identify a number of principles that I consider to be very much fundamental to any economy that is attempting in the present day to attain sustainable economic development and growth. And then I would look at a number of strategies and policies that are necessary and sufficient conditions to achieve sustainable economic growth. Okay, there we go. So let's start off by looking at, I hope this has given you the first chart on, well, this chart on the first slide. And what can you see there? Well, you'd see that we've been experiencing an upward trend in economic growth from 1960s to now. You would also see two very distinct periods of high economic growth spurts, if you will. It occurred in the 1970s and early 1980s, and it also occurred between the period 1994 to 2008. Of course, what you would appreciate is that that would have taken us from economic growth of just a few hundred million US dollars in the early 60s to roughly around just over $28 billion of GDP in 2014. This chart will also show you that between the period 1994 to 2008, Trinidad and Tobago's economy averaged 6% of economic growth on an annual basis. Of course, between 2009 and 2012, there was actually very weak economic activity, and some rebound occurred in 2013, but after that, we've had flatline or negative growth. Now, before I go on to look at the development strategies, perhaps one of the things I need to relate is, well, what caused this sudden decline over the last 6 years? Well, there are four key things. There are more, but there's four key things. We start with the Macondo disaster that occurred in the Gulf of Mexico. This disaster resulted in BP upgrading all its facilities internationally around the globe. Thing is, when they attempted to replace machinery, there was a curtailment of output. This affected output in the energy sector and, of course, had a dampening effect on growth of GDP in the years which there was upgrade of facilities. We also experienced the end of the commodity super cycle, which resulted in lowering in demand for international commodities and, of course, the subsequent fall in international prices. Of course, we are, among other things, we are also seeing the effects of that today. Third, one of the things that has occurred in the economy, and many people would have heard the Prime Minister talk about it and a number of commentators, is what appears to be the terminal decline of the oil sector. There has been some decline in the natural gas production. But of course, what we expect is with the coming on stream of new fields, there will be some uptick in production. Whether it returns to the previous levels, that is a question that we await to see. And finally, there was much hope for the non-energy sector. But, you know, one of the things that we have learned in the past is that once there is some decline in the energy sector, the non-energy sector follows suit after some lag. And true to form, that's happening now. Now, there are a number of strategies that were adopted over the years that contributed to the level of GDP that we experienced in the last maybe 6 years. Certainly, one could identify the industrialization by invitation. All this said is, look, we didn't have capital endowment. We needed to invite investors to our country. We tried import substituting industrialization, but unfortunately, well, that was characterized by high tariffs, negative lists, and you know, the establishment of industrial parks, and we saw quite a number of manufacturing concerns develop. We had manufacturing of radios, televisions, cars, all the way through to furniture. And of course, one of the things that took place during the 1980s when the price of oil fell, we experienced a real fall off in government revenues. We also had a significant fall in foreign exchange earnings. We had high debt levels, and this led to balance of payments difficulties, which resulted in us going to the IMF and ultimately having a structural adjustment program introduced. This led to some restructuring of the economy, a new economic model. Maxwell Stamp helped with that. And of course, what happened is that we found ourselves introducing financial liberalization to the economy and diversify a lot of the government sector. Now, we also engage in resource-based industrialization, which would have been the point leaser strategy. Of course, the problem with the key feature of the point leaser strategy was that it attempted to have us move up the value chain. We didn't want to any longer be just exporting only raw materials. We wanted to, of course, move up that value chain and gain and exploit our natural resource through investment by the public sector in the offshore sector for distribution onshore. Well, that's a good idea, but what's the problem with that? Well, the real problem lies in the fact that if you are taking rents from the offshore sector to fund unproductive consumption or low productive public sector make work schemes or support a very large non-traded distribution and services sector, it may be great politics. It may also result in some temporary improvement in the standard of living. It may certainly involve periods of prosperity. But the thing is that it does not address the fundamental issues of sustainable economic growth and development. And of course, that is laid bare once you have an exogenous shock as we had in the 1980s and as we have now. So, we also need to point out that the state took a far more active role in the economy during the 1970s. And of course, it was fortuitous because the first oil shock provided significant economic rents to the state, which they were able to invest in the economy. And invest they did, about $4 billion in shares by 1985 in over 62 enterprises. And they also played a significant part in production. 62 state enterprises and utilities contributed about 16% of GDP by 1985. And of course, there was significant diversification. The problem with the diversification is a lot of these enterprises was heavily dependent on the government for support. And of course, all this was laid bare in the 1980s when the price of oil fell. And of course, we talked about it, the need for entering into a standby arrangement with the IMF. Now, we can't begin to talk about development strategies without talking about the Vision 2020 plan. It was perhaps one of the most comprehensive and well-developed economic plans coming out of, you know, developing states. As I said, it was so comprehensive, it attempted to touch most aspects of our life, not just economic aspects. And of course, there's no way I could do justice in the short period. The reality is that it identified a number of sectors that was supposed to result in export-led growth of the non-energy sector, from the non-energy sector, and lead us to developed nation status. Of course, we all know that what transpired eventually, that this plan was abandoned. So where do we go from here? The reality is that the latest stage of economic evolution is characterized by a significant technological innovation. Global competitiveness needs technological change with new products and processes. And this is driven by research communities. So what has to be our plan? What do we do? Well, I have identified three critical principles. The first I've identified is high-value goods and services. We need to identify high-value goods and services. But not just high-value goods and services. We need to ensure that the goods and services that are high-value, that we enter the product chain and allows us to have high value added, which gives us a bigger take and allows us to maintain our prosperity. We also need to increase capital intensity, which means we need to increase domestic capital in the economy, thereby lowering the per unit cost of production, increasing productivity, and making us more competitive. And last principle that I'm suggesting is import productivity. And this seeks to ensure the efficiency in the use of our domestic foreign currency. Foreign currency. Now, that's important. Why? And what it means is that for every dollar we spend on productive use, we must ensure that we gain the greatest benefit for each dollar spent. Is it providing us with the best use of our foreign currency? Is the economic activity providing us with the best use? Well, there are a number of policies and strategies that are necessary, that are fundamental, that are necessary and sufficient to ensure economic growth and development. We need to start off by looking at perhaps value added. We need to focus on no longer just the sale of raw material or low-level products, but must move up the value chain of or the international value chain of products. We need to have the political will, which allows us to say we are going to provide fiscal incentives to those producers who are targeting high-value products and are attempting to increase this increase value added of these high-value products. That political will must also avoid being trapped by those sons and daughters who may attempt to pursue self-interest at the expense of the economy as a whole. Now, we need a national plan. A national plan that attempts to encourage our entrepreneurs to select or enter the upper troughs of new product cycles. This national plan must also have an industrial policy that is export-oriented. The national plan, and I must say before I go on, the national plan must also transcend time, it must transcend regimes. It must not be changed when there is an election and a new regime comes into office. I was going to go use the illustration of the Olympics, you know, that countries are like in a relay race, and that when the gun goes off, all the countries take off. But when the first battle change occurs, what happens is the election occurs. There's a new regime, we take all our battles and head back to the starting line. That That doesn't make sense to me. So I'm saying that we also need to have export-oriented industrial policy, simply because we need to recognize that foreign exchange is the lifeblood of small island developing states. It also recognizes that we have small market shares, small markets, most of these small islands. And we may not have the market size to achieve self-sustaining growth as espoused by Rostow and Schumpeter. But we can't give up. We have something which is the integration movement. And that integration movement allows us to say we can, with proper negotiation and strategy, exploit a larger market share, which gives us economies of scale and allows us to lower per unit cost and therefore become more competitive in the world. We also need to engage in economic diversification, restructure our economy, move away from dependence of old products that are in terminal decline. If we have to do that, we have to invest, increase capital investment in the economy, in the non-energy sector, which means attracting foreign direct investors and influencing local investors to target the non-energy sector. That calls for creativity, but it also calls for a national plan that is very focused. We need also to invest in our human resource, which is our biggest asset. We need to ensure that we target investment in those skills that are required based on products selected in the national plan. Now, this is a problem because essentially people say that there's a philosophical difference between those who advocate education for as an end product and those who think that education, when you have limited resources and you live in a small island development state, you need to target your resources. You need to target those skills that are required in your national plan, in your industrial plan. Ladies and gentlemen, the last thing I want to leave with you is simply this. It requires a cultural change in most of us sitting here to remove our dependence from the government, to embrace risk, to see risk as part of the blossoming of entrepreneurial activity that is required. We need to fan the flames of entrepreneurial activity. Our government must, and state institutions must, in large measure, reduce risk, not take over risk. And most of all, we need to create institutions that provide financing for projects, project development and entrepreneurial activity. There's so much to say on this, but ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your time. Have a good evening.